Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. It's my third video. I had to start over again. I lost my place. I'm trying to use this e-sword, and sometimes you can somehow jump to another, what you were looking at last time. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as I said, the Lord has given me a word for 2015. This is my third video. You should watch the other two. They're good. The Lord gave me a word for 2014, and that word is separation. Separation from the world. And the Lord gave me this and told me this in the immortal words of Neil Sedaka. Breaking up is hard to do. So people are in love with the world. You know that song, Breaking Up is Hard to Do? You know, if you go, then I'll be blue, because breaking up is hard to do. People don't want to be separated from the world. But God calls us to be holy, come out from among them, separate ourselves from the world. The Bible says if you're friends with the world, you're enemy of God. And I've got some Bible verse I want to look at. But let me ask you a question. Jesus came to earth. It says he was full of grace and truth, John chapter 1, full of love. It says that, you know, a broken reed, you know, he wouldn't cause any, even a reed to break, you know. He was walking in all this love, if you read the words of Jesus. But how is it that the world crucified the most loving, gracious person that ever lived, but somehow the world loves you? You're not rejected by the world. How is it the world rejected Christ but doesn't reject you? That's the question. Why is that? So what's the difference, you know? Are you in love with the world? Because breaking up is hard to do. The Lord is calling his people to be holy. Now all you greasy gracers, go believe what you want to believe. But I want to tell you right now, you are taking a few verses out of context and putting your hope and faith in sin. And even Paul said, shall we sin more that God's grace may more abound? God forbid. As I mentioned in a video I made the other day, obviously Jesus needs to be corrected, and he didn't get the message. Because in John chapter 15, Jesus tells the famous parable that I am the true vine. Starting with John chapter 15, verse 1. He said, I am the true vine, you are the branches. You know, without me, you can do nothing. You cannot bear fruit. Abide in me and I will abide in you. Remain in me and I will remain in you. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You can't bear any fruit. Any branch that doesn't bear fruit shall be cut down and thrown into the fire. I mean, what part of that doesn't people understand? Jesus even cursed the fig tree. And what was he talking about? Why did Jesus curse the fig tree? Why, brothers and sisters? You know, you're like Peter. You're just thinking in the natural, in the flesh. You're supposed to be spirit-filled. But of course, you denominational people are not spirit-filled. That's why you're denominational people. You're hiding from the power of God. You have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. That's why you're hiding behind your old denominational doctrine. Peter got in his mind, oh, wow, Jesus, you cursed the fig tree. That was cool. Why did Jesus curse the fig tree and it died? Because it didn't bear any fruit. That's what he was doing. It was a parable and an example to show what God was doing with Israel. They had not borne any fruit. Look at all those parables Jesus told. Read there in Matthew chapter 21, 22, 23. Along in there when Jesus said, you know, the parable of the vineyard. He sent servants there and they beat one, threw out another one, didn't give them the money. They robbed them. Talking about the prophets. And then the owner of the vineyard sent his son to get the harvest of the vineyard. And they said, oh, this is the son. Let's kill him. He's the heir of the vineyard. Let's kill him. He's talking about himself, about Jesus. He was talking about himself in the parable. And then he asked them, what do you think the owner of the vineyard is going to do to those people? And then the Pharisee said, oh, they'll get rid of them. He'll bring them to a wretched end. And Jesus said, that's right. He will take the vineyard from them and give it to another people that will bear fruit. Is that replacement theology? I guess Jesus didn't get the memo about replacement theology. Of course, I'm not preaching replacement theology. But there are people who are watching this video who are Israeli worshipers, equating Israel with God, equating Israel as above the church. Those promises God made to Abraham, I'll bless those that bless you and curse those that curse you. The Bible says we are spiritual children of Abraham. We, the true born-again Christians, are adopted children of Abraham. Those promises are for us also. And Paul said, the beloved Paul said, that circumcision is of no effect. Those who serve the Lord and live right are circumcised in the heart. Those that do not live right are uncircumcised, whether they be circumcised in the flesh or not. They're separated from God. They're not really children of God. Only those who do the will of my Father, Jesus said. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but those that do the will of my Father. I'm talking about two different topics here. I'm talking about people that worship Israel, and I'm talking about the Judaizers, people who think they can follow the law. Israel's day is coming. God has a day to deal with Israel. It's called the time of Jacob's trouble. The day of the Lord, people keep saying, how can you say there's a pre-tribulation rapture when the Lord will return in the day? Yeah, the day of the Lord is not one day. It is a season. It's a tribulation period. It's not a literally one human earthly day. It is the season of his return, including really the thousand-year reign of Christ. It's part of the day of the Lord. You know, a day with the Lord is a thousand years. And Jesus is coming back like on 6 days. God created the earth and the seventh day he rested. There are 6,000 years of mankind and then the thousand-year reign of Christ. Judge in spiritual righteousness, not according to the flesh. Just like Peter when he looked at that fig tree and thought it was really cool that Jesus cursed it and it died. That's true. But he was missing the point. It's not just, oh, let's have some power to curse a fig tree. And that's awesome. That's why lots of people, too, they get all caught up. Well, I prayed for somebody and they got healed. Or, I spoke in tongues and all that. That's great. But the big picture, Jesus Christ came and died on the cross for us. Jesus is God. There's a heaven. There's eternity. There's eternal consequences to what I do. There's judgment. There's a future. There's the judgment seat of Christ for those who are Christians. For those who are not really Christians or never Christians or the backslidden and fallen away and the never wases, there is the white throne judgment of God. That's much more important than the fact that, I preached this sermon before about this. Because the Lord is kind of changing what I was going to say. Absolutely changing what I was going to say. Okay, so just bear with me. I know you denominational people you'll say, yes, God can heal somebody sometimes, maybe, or maybe it's like Paul with a thorn in the flesh. God heals people all the time, and that's great. And that's great. And I pray many people to be healed. That's not a problem. But Jesus said, if your right hand offends you, cut it off. Or if your right eye offends you, gouge it out. It's better to enter heaven with one good eye than to enter hell with hellfire with both eyes. So much more important than saying, ooh, I saw a miracle. Somebody got healed. Ooh, that's awesome. But it's much more awesome and much more important to walk in holiness. That's what Jesus is saying. If your right eye offends you, pluck it out. Don't worry about seeing with your eyes. In the natural, it's much better to enter heaven blind than it is to walk on this earth and see all the lust of the flesh that you're chasing after. Whether it be physical lust of a person, or lust of money, lust of power, lust of greed, whatever it is, the lust and the pride of life that's got you hell bent and hell bound. God is telling me to tell you, be holy, for I am holy. 1 Peter 1, 16 is a quote from the Old Testament. Let's start with verse 15. 1 Peter 1, 15. But as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manners of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without respect of persons, judges according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. Another Bible verse. Work out your fear. And so, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, if you're once saved, always saved, you can say a prayer at 8 years old, live like the devil the rest of your life, and that's what you believe. Of course you don't have any fear of God. God is a holy, righteous God. That's what brings salvation. What the problem is, even not talking about once saved, always saved, the truth is it's just false converts. False converts. If millions and millions of people have a mental assent and agreement that Jesus Christ is King and Jesus Christ is Lord and Jesus Christ is the Savior. But it's right here. They haven't been converted in the heart, because if they were truly converted in the heart, they would fear the Lord. They would work out their salvation with fear and trembling. They would be on the internet watching videos. They'd be asking. As I've mentioned several times, I'll mention again, whenever I make a video and say something like I'm saying now, the same people email me and say, can you pray for me if I'm really saved? If you are working out your salvation with fear and trembling, that's a good sign that you are saved. You're concerned about it. Those people that tell me, oh, I can sin all I want. I've had people, there are people that have YouTube channels who make comments, go around, you know, trolling everybody's YouTube channel, saying that you, and they rejoice. I've seen it where they're writing and rejoicing in their sin and use cuss words and laugh and say, oh, I can cuss all I want, do what I want. They are mocking God. They're putting God to the test, as it says in the NIV. Jesus said, when he was tempted by Satan to jump off the top of the temple, he said in the King James, he said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And that's what these people are doing. They're tempting the Lord. They're tempting the severity. The Bible says it's a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. God is a consuming fire. Do not tempt the Lord your God. Now let me say this. We all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23, there is no doubt that we sin every day. But there's a difference. And that's the problem with these old greasy graciers. They try to twist things and change it around and justify themselves. Oh, you think you're better than us. You're boastfully bragging that you're perfect. No. I sin. The difference is God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. The difference is I know that sinning is never good. It's never good. It's never right. It's never pleasing and acceptable to God. Any sin, anytime, is an abomination and an insult to the living God who bought us with a price. You're not your own, but you've been bought with a price. So the attitude of these people is, hey, I can sin. It's all cool because nobody can be perfect. That is a temptation. You are trying to tempt the Lord your God. And what does the Bible say? God does not tempt a man, and God cannot be tempted. What you're doing is you're storing up wrath for yourself. And then the thing about people is the people think they got away with something today and God didn't do anything about it. But the day comes. The day comes when the fullness of God's wrath has come upon people. Just like with Sodom and Gomorrah, just like the fullness of God's wrath came there with those places where the Israelites went, when the nation of Israel went back, God spoke a prophecy to Abraham. Abraham was in a deep sleep in a dream, and God told him that his children would go into bondage and all this. It was in Egypt. And then they would come back after so many years, and they would enter the land, and they would clear the land of people, the land that God had showed Abraham, the promised land, the land of Canaan, which is now the land of Israel. God said, because the fullness of the sin of those people is not full yet. When the fullness of the Canaanites was full, the amount of sin they committed got to a certain level, the fullness of times, God sent the nation of Israel in there to bring judgment on this people. Nation of Israel, the sin of the northern kingdom. When they split, when King Solomon died, they split in two because of King Solomon's sin. God split the country. You need to read your Bible. He split it to the northern and southern kingdom, a.k.a. Israel and Judah. Israel's sin was so bad, the nation of Israel, it went on for about 250 years, and then God removed them because of the fullness of their sin. Tribe of Judah, he reserved a remnant. Why? For the sake of his promise to King David, that someone would sit on his throne forever, a.k.a. the Lord Jesus Christ. God took Israel into captivity for 70 years there with Daniel, Ezekiel. Jeremiah was left back there in Jerusalem. Then they came back and reestablished the nation until the time of Christ. Destroyed in 70 A.D., then they went back in 1948. All of those things were the promises of God that made a King David, that his throne would be occupied perpetually, eternally, by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But the fullness of those people's sin hit a point where the wrath of God broke out against them. What did God tell Moses? He's slow to anger and abounding in love. Slow to anger, but he does anger. People say, well, God has emotions. Yes, we're created in the image of God. The love. People say, well, you know, God is love. The Bible says God is love. And all the backsliders I know, they'll say, well, God is love. Yes. And what? That's just one emotion. God also has anger. He also has wrath. His anger is kindled against sin. God's wrath abides on sin. That's what Jesus protects us from. When we repent, we are covered by the blood of Jesus. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Let me read something else to you. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 2. But there were false prophets among the people. He's talking about in the time of Israel, and he's talking about the end times. Peter, 2 Peter chapter 2. And there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, It reminds me of Joel Osteen. It reminds me, he's the most famous. It reminds me of all the mainline denominations, Presbyterians, Lutherans, all those denominations today here in the end times. They fit this category more than the Catholic Church. More than the Catholic Church. Listen to what it says. Among you, who privily or privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Swift destruction, even denying the Lord, denying the virgin birth. All those mainline Protestant denominations are denying the Word of God is God's Word. They say the Bible contains God's Word, but it's not God. It's not all God's Word. That's what they're saying. The Bible contains God's Word. So parts of it are not God's Word. That's what they mean. They don't believe in the virgin birth anymore. They do not believe in the deity of Christ. All these things. All those main non-denominations are saying these things. Go watch the news. It's been going on for about 10 years. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be spoken evil of. This is very complicated language. I'm going to switch over to the English Standard Version, which I don't normally use. I want to use it to make this easier. And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them the way of truth will be blasphemed. This is English Standard Version. And in their greed they will exploit you with false words. Prosperity gospel. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. This is what I was just talking about. I didn't think about this part of the text when I was looked at it a minute ago. And if God did not spare the angels when they sinned, the fallen angels who slept with women, but cast them into hell and committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until judgment. If he did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a herald of righteousness, with seven others when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly. If by turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he condemned them to extinction, because making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly. And if he rescued righteous Lot, greatly distressed by the sensual conduct of the wicked, for as that righteous man lived among them day after day, he was tormented, his righteous soul, over their lawless deeds that he saw and heard. That the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and to keep the unrighteous under punishment until the day of judgment. Now, he delivered Lot not because he was Abraham's nephew. Abraham had other relatives. He didn't deliver Lot because some other reason. He delivered him because Lot was not living in sin. It says Lot was vexed by the evil they were doing. Lot was living a righteous life, even though he was living in that city. He wasn't living in sin with them, and oh, because he's Abraham's nephew, I'm going to deliver him. Oh, because they're say they're a Christian, I'm going to deliver them. No, because they're living righteously. The Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and to keep the unrighteous under punishment until the day of judgment. And especially though it's talking about being in hell, hell is a holding place for the lake of fire. Okay? So those who are under punishment until the day of judgment, the great white throne judgment will be people thrown from hell. They go through judgment of how much punishment they will get, and they'll be cast into the lake of fire after that. Verse 10, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 10, and especially those who indulge in the lust of defiling passion, homosexual activities, natural sex, bestiality and whatnot, and despise authority. Bold and willful, they do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious ones. Whereas angels, though greater in might and power, do not pronounce blasphemous judgments against them before the Lord. But these, like irrational animals or brute beasts, King James says, creatures of instinct, born to be caught and destroyed, blaspheming about matters of which they are ignorant, will also be destroyed in their destruction, suffering the wrong as a wage for the wrongdoing. Let's see. Let me go back to the King James, because I'm lost with that English Standard Version, what I'm looking for. Let's go down here. Where were I at? Where was I at? Oh, let's see. And shall receive the reward of unrighteousness. He's talking about these false people in the church at the end times. Shall receive the reward of unrighteousness, as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Spots they are, blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceiving, while they feast with you. I'm talking about taking communion with you and all that. Let's see. That is verse 13 verse 13, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. I want to look a word here in the Greek that I was just thinking about. It says to riot. You know, when you look, it's talking about debauchery and all this, and I think, and I just wanted to confirm with this word. In Hebrew, when you're talking about, they use this translation of rioting, they're talking about like an orgy and stuff. And so here it says that it's to break up, especially in mind and body, by indulgence, to become totally out of control by indulgences, effeminacy, that is luxury or debauchery. To riot is one meaning, to literally riot, but it's also meaning to just break out in an orgies is part of this kind of thing too. That's why I'm thinking of these homosexual, you know, taking over those denominations, already been taken over by homosexuals. And I believe, just like in Sodom and Gomorrah, I believe as, you know, part of the end times, I believe the Antichrist will probably be homosexual, because it alludes to that in Daniel, that he will not love women. He will not be a lover of women. And it, you know, also in Sodom and Gomorrah, you have the same connection. We see this, and in Romans chapter 1, we see the last phase before God's judgment is outright wide open homosexuality, and everybody's into it. So the gay marriage thing is a big step in that direction of outright rioting against of law, unlawlessness, you know, of being unlawful against the laws of God. You're talking about of nature here. We're talking about the basic laws of God, not the Ten Commandments. We're talking about it's God's natural law from the very beginning that men and women, you know, men and men don't lie together. It's not even about what it says in the law. It's just natural thing that, to do. It's not, you know, it's unnatural acts that they're doing, you know. And that's the whole point. The unnatural act of it against procreation that God created us for the purpose of our being. Part of that is to procreate. And homosexuality is a blasphemous slap in the face to God's first covenant with Adam and Eve. You know, a man and a woman. The marriage. Let's see. They are spots and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. They're in the church, the tares, having eyes full of adultery. They cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls. They're tricking other people, you know, just like, you know, Satan beguiled Eve. They're beguiling unstable souls. And I made a reference to this the other day, and people say, oh, Satan beguiled Eve. People can beguile people. Beguiling unstable souls, people that are weak. Oh, you can live any way you want, and you're still saved. And heart, they have exercised with covetous practices. Cursed children, which have forsaken the right way, have gone astray, following the way of Baalam, the son of Bozar, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. And it talks about how the dumb ass even spoke to him. He uses these. As a matter of fact, it's the same quote that's from Jude, actually originally quoted from the book of Enoch. While they promised them liberty, let's see, for they, verse 18, Peter chapter 2, verse 18, for when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lust of the flesh, through much wantonness, those that were clean escape from them who live in error. Escape from them, guys. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought into bondage. You can be free and then put back into bondage right here. For if after they had escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they're already saved, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse than them than from the beginning. For it hath been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed in her is wallowing in the mire again. Is wallowing in the mire. Now I said all that. Listen to that last part again. These old form of godliness, but denying the power of your these denominations teaching once saved, always saved. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 119. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought into bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollution of the world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse than for that with them than from the beginning. So in the beginning, they were lost and without hope in the world on their way to hell. So if you backslide all the way off the map, you know, you can backslide a little bit. He's saying they've been overcome. He says that they've been entangled with the world again and overcome. So it's not everybody that backslides for 5 minutes. You're going, you know, it's a persistent living. That's a whole nother teaching. Persistent living in sin and then just walking away from the Lord, denying the Lord, and living on to a certain point where the Lord will not continue to strive with you. As he says in Genesis chapter 6, God will not always strive and beg people to come to him. There's a point where you become a reprobate mind. It says their latter end is worse with them than it is in the beginning. How could it be worse than going to hell? That doesn't sound like one saved, always saved to me. For it is better for them to not have known the way of righteousness than after they had known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again. The sow was washed. It was clean. They got saved. It wasn't that, oh, they heard the gospel and walked away. No, they were saved. They were clean. The sow was cleaned. She was washed. To her wallowing in the mire, she went back to rolling around in the world, in the mud. You better stop trying to make these Bible verses say what you want them to say so that you can sleep at night and live in your sin. Be ye holy. Breaking up is hard to do. Breaking up with the world is hard to do. It's not an easy thing. It is not easy. Jesus said, whoever, you know, follows me and then turns back from the plow is not worthy of me. Jesus said, you know, if you look back at the world, you're not worthy of me. Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. He said, who does not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. I mean, what part of that doesn't people understand? You think Jesus is just joking or clowning or it means something else? I mean, what part of hundreds of Bible verses don't you understand? There are people that messaged me when I made the video the other day and said, well, how do you explain Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, where it says, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. That's salvation. That's the day you got saved. You were saved the day you got saved by grace through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. God gave you the grace to get saved, and you believed, you repented, you called on the name of the Lord, you got saved. That's talking about that day. There are hundreds of Bible verses I've quoted in this video and the video I made the other day, two videos. I made one, it said, repent or be left behind from the rapture. I made a video the next day saying, once saved, always saved. Is that true? Or something like that. I titled it about once saved, always saved. I've quoted 100 Bible verses. Just now, I've probably quoted 20, 30, 40 Bible verses to you to show that once saved, always saved is not true. And then people want to quote just a handful of Bible verses. You have to take all the Bible verses in context of the rest of them. So if I made you a list of a 200 Bible verses that says that you need to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, and then you give me 5 Bible verses that could seem to suggest that you can't lose your salvation, maybe. What you're going to do, you have to take it all in context. It's all one package. You look at all the New Testament particularly as one word of God. It's a united, unified book. So they're not contradicted. So if you believe the Bible and you believe that there's no contradiction in God's word, then you have to weigh it yourself. Go look at it. Stop looking at the Bible through your rose-colored glasses. Stop looking at the Bible through your doctrinal lenses. Take off your doctrinal lenses and be a truth seeker. I am a truth seeker. I am not a doctrine enforcer or a doctrine believer. I am a truth seeker. As much as the Bible is Calvinist, I'm a Calvinist. As much as the Bible is free will, I'm free will. As much as the Bible is once saved, always saved, I'm once saved, always saved. As much as the Bible is holiness, walking in holiness and righteousness, I'm walking in holiness and righteousness. I'm conforming myself to the image of Christ as I am led by the Spirit of God. The Bible said those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 16. His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. Examine yourself, as the Bible says, and see if ye be in the faith. That's what it says. It says examine yourself to see if you be in the faith. It's time for you to do like Jacob. Wrestle with God. Wrestle with God till you get the answer, till you get the blessing, that you know that you know that you know that you're saved. And that's the word from the Lord for 2014. Come out from among them. God knows that breaking up is hard to do, but you need to do it. You need to break up with this world. end your relationship, your love affair with this world. Stop putting the things of this world ahead of God.